Welcome to the 2022 virtual reverse site visit. My name is Tracy Morton. I'm the Director of Population Health at the National Rural Health Resource Center, or the Center. And at the Center, we serve as a Technical Assistance and Services Center, or TASC, to support the 45 state FLEX programs. We're really honored to serve as TASC, and we're so excited to have you here this year as we begin, or maybe continue, on an interesting healthcare transition. We hope the content of this year's reverse site visit speaks to you on a professional level and provides you the tools that you need to bridge the future. We'd like to take the opportunity to thank the Federal Office of Rural Health Policy for their continued leadership and partnership within the FLEX program. And we also want to thank our planning committee members who went the extra mile to ensure a great event. As we get started, I want to share with you a few details about the CVEN platform that we're using. As a registered attendee, you are given a special link to join this event. And from that link, you can access all of the plenary, breakout, and discussion rooms. And at the top of the attendee hub, there's a menu for the different sections of the event. Aside from the discussion rooms, each of the sessions and breakout sessions will be recorded and made available in the same link shortly after that session concludes. The recordings will also be made available on the Center website in the coming weeks. You might encounter some technical assistance needs during the event, and so I want to share with you how to get in touch with somebody if you do need some help. To call, you can call 1-833-987-3703. That's 1-833-987-3703, or you can send an email to rhrcsupport@cvent.com. That's rhrcsupport@cvent.com. We hope you don't encounter any technical issues, but it might come up, and that's how you get in touch with us. Throughout the event, we encourage your questions and your interactions with the speakers, and really encourage your questions and interactions with one another. So we have some different features this year that we'd like to encourage you to use. And those include discussion boards and some instant networking opportunities throughout the event. These can be found under the Community tab at the top of your page. And the conversations have actually been started already there, so please join in and share your thoughts. Instant networking is pretty neat, and it opens twice a day at the beginning before the reverse site visit begins, and then at the end of the day when the sessions conclude. And that's an opportunity for you to randomly meet another attendee via video chat. The room will connect you with somebody for up to 5 minutes where you can share with them who you are, what you do, what ideas you have, and see if you have some commonalities. If you have any questions during this session, you can utilize the chat box feature by clicking on the chat icon on the right side of your screen. The TASC team will be monitoring that during the presentations and either answering your questions or we'll communicate them over to the speaker for you. As always, our chat rooms are open and we're available for your comments and questions. Our theme this year is Bridging the Future, Adaptation, Equity, and Innovation. These three areas of focus relay the importance of the times that we live in and the importance of the role that each of us play in providing quality healthcare to rural communities. Be sure to ask questions over the coming days, meet and welcome the newest FLEX program partners and participants, and engage in meaningful ways. Together, we can move forward in new and exciting ways, crossing that bridge of what's been a challenging few years into a future that's full of promise for everyone. This time, I'd like to introduce to you Tom Morris. Tom Morris serves as the Associate Administrator for the Rural Health Policy in the Health Resources and Services Administration, or HRSA, of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, or HHS. In that role, Tom oversees the work of the Federal Office of Rural Health Policy, which is charged with advising the HHS Secretary on rural health issues. The office, which has an annual budget of $317 million, administers a range of research and capacity-building grant programs that serve rural communities. In 2012, Tom was the recipient of the HHS Distinguished Service Award. And in 2015, he was awarded a Presidential Rank Award for Meritorious Service. Tom has testified on rural health issues before the House and Senate throughout his federal career. And he has past work experience in the U.S. Senate in various policy and program positions within HRSA and HHS. Welcome, Tom. We're so happy to have you with us today.
Tracy, thanks so much. I appreciate the opportunity to join you all. It's kind of hard to believe that 2022 is the 25th anniversary of the FLEX program. It's a good time, I think, to have the focus you have on the future of the program. And I'm really excited that y'all are going to be diving into this in more detail. And also was really happy to see Dennis Wagner as your closeout speaker. I've known Dennis for many years. He understands these issues you're dealing with, quality improvement, performance improvement, but he also knows rural. He grew up in rural Montana, and I just can't think of a better speaker for this particular meeting. And before we get started, just a huge thanks to the Flex team, for Laura Seifert and Natalia Vargas and Talia Chapel. They really did a fantastic job, I think, putting all this together. But of course, they couldn't have done it without the support of Tracy and her whole team at the National Rural Health Resource Center. And so thank you to everybody for their work on that. And also appreciate your nod to the planning committee and the Flex grantees who had a hand in shaping the agenda. So we'll go to the next slide. So across government, you know, there's always a push to make sure that we can measure the impact of our programs. That's been true since the day that the first budget passed for this program. And yet we've always had this sort of dynamic tension, because just by looking at the name of the program, Flex, we want to maintain some degree of flexibility from state to state, because all the states are so different. And yet, in many cases, you're involved in some of the same activities, but the context may be a little bit different. And so, you know, we have this dynamic tension of wanting to give you the flexibility to meet your local needs while also being responsible to the Congress and showing that the program is having a national impact. And part of that is figuring out how best to measure that impact and to make sure that the measures we have are actually valid to the community served by these critical access hospitals. And so I think you all have done a really nice job of that. At the same time, I know it hasn't been easy. I've been impressed this year in particular with the quality improvement labs. And you know, you all are at an interesting juncture in the sense that you're moving on beyond just reporting to actually using the information from the reporting to drive performance improvement. And so, you know, there's a great partnership in place between the Flex grantees, with TASC, with our team at the Federal Office of Rural Policy, the Arquita team, and Stratus Health, the Flex monitoring team at Minnesota, North Carolina, and Southern Maine. So we're all in this together when you think about it, because we all have the same goals here, which is to make sure that the program meets the needs of CAHs while also showing a national impact. And so I just appreciate everybody being able to really focus on that, and just appreciate the engagement of the state offices and the Flex programs, in particular for the last 2.5 years. Many of you are involved in the Small Hospital Improvement Program, and the Congress has provided a fair amount of resources to push out to respond to the pandemic. And certainly CHAs across this country have had to stand up and go through some really difficult times over the past couple of years. And yet, you know, I think they've stood up and done really well and shown that they can play an important part in the pandemic response. So, you know, as we come out the other side of this, it's certainly not over yet. Really am very much appreciative of all you've done in addition to the regular Flex work that we've had going on. And then the other part that you've been really instrumental in is, as we've been able to put a lot of funding out to support rural health clinics during the pandemic, so many of the CHs own and operate provider-based rural health clinics. And so your ability to help those clinics tap into the money, whether it was for vaccine confidence or testing and mitigation, as well as many RHCs who are getting directly from the federal government, getting vaccines and testing equipment. So just again, I think on behalf of the office and the agency, I just want to thank you for all the extra work you did, you know, since the pandemic began. Next slide. So just a quick nod to some of the issues we're tracking. Obviously, rural hospital closures continue to be front and center. We've only had 5 over the last 2 years or so, and that's a good thing. And yet we know none of the underlying forces that were causing double-digit rural hospital closures each year since 2010 have gone away. In fact, they've probably been masked by the infusion of cash, the Provider Relief Fund and Paycheck Protection Act, et cetera. So, you know, I think now that we're at this juncture, I think we're all sort of wondering what's going to happen next, and are we going to see a return to those prior level of closures? The University of North Carolina has a really great research brief out about this, I think is important reading, because just like we're trying to educate our policymakers about what to expect in the next 2 years, similarly, I'm sure you get those same questions too. And so please tap into UNC for any help they can give you in sort of setting a context for that. The other issue, telehealth, I think is front and center for all of us. We know what a difference it made during the pandemic, and it's no longer, you know, sort of a rural specific issue, but yet something that nationwide is being used and used at a much higher degree than any time in the past. And yet there's this stubborn sort of gap between rural and urban utilization. And there are a number of reasons for that. But I think as we move forward to finalize policy, to either, you know, enact or continue some of the public health flexibilities that have allowed telehealth to take float. I think we have to be conscious of some of the challenges that remain in rural communities. And we just encourage all of you to stay in touch with the Office for the Advancement of Telehealth. As you know, it used to be part of our office, but with the growth of telehealth, it is now a standalone office, and yet they have still have a very deep interest in working on rural issues. And so want that relationship between the flex coordinators and OAT to continue the best it can. I'll talk a minute about some of the unique EMS issues that are going on. Rural residency training is an issue that's important not only to our office, but also to HRSA. Many of you know that we run the Rural Residency Planning Grant Program, and that's done really well in terms of setting up new residency programs in this country. The challenge for CHs, the CHs that you serve, is that moving a residency program to be supported by Medicare over the long term does not work as well in a CH cost-based reimbursement. So one of the things we're really interested in teeing up is rural health clinics are eligible for the Teaching Health Center program, where you can get money directly from HRSA to cover the cost of resident training. And so there's a new competition every year for this program, and we'd really like to see a rural health clinic apply. And if it had a provider-based CAH, it could do some of the rotations there, whether it's for emergency services or inpatients. So while CHs can't apply for the Teaching Health Center program, their rural health clinics can. And so if you have any interest in this, please get in touch with us. We'd like to get a couple of test cases going and see if we can replicate that. And then the final policy issue I just want to point out to you is the president's budget this year included the first time ever an administration put forth a budget proposal to support rural health clinics. And this is a $10 million request from the administration to fund a grant program that would add rural mental health services to rural health clinics. And certainly, as many of you know, behavioral health has been a big issue for the Congress this year. They're marking up a number of bills, and our hope is that this will be part of it. So far, the House has picked up a $5 million proposal for expanding mental health into rural health clinics. And it's also coupled with a proposal in the president's budget that would expand Medicare coverage in rural health clinics and community health centers to family therapists and licensed professional counselors. We know those folks are a little bit easier to recruit in rural communities. And so our hope is that the Congress also enacts this as well. Moving to the next slide. All right, so I mentioned EMS, and I just want to give a quick shout out to all the flex programs that have really kept this issue front and center. While I know it has a little bit of a less point of emphasis than the quality improvement and performance improvement work, I'm still glad that it's a key part of what we do in flex, and 30 states have identified EMS as a focus, and a number of you have gotten supplemental dollars to do a deeper dive on this. And I think what you've done a great job of is keeping this issue front and center as a larger national rural health policy issue. We hope that focus will be added this year by the Southern Maine, University of Southern Maine study that's going to come out and identify the national, the number of deserts nationally, EMS deserts. And by that we mean where a rural resident resides 25 miles away or more away from where the rural ambulance is housed. And I think as we've seen some of the preliminary findings, you see Montana and New Mexico here, you can see that the need out there is very great, and that some people live in particularly precarious situations in terms of their access to emergency medical services. Because of all these issues, these concerns, the National Advisory Committee on Rural Health and Human Services has picked this up as a policy topic, and they'll be releasing a policy brief that will go to the Secretary of HHS fairly shortly. Next slide. We're also interested in what's coming next in terms of the CMS's creation of the new rural emergency hospital. This is a hospital, as many of you know, that doesn't have inpatient services, but gets some unique payments otherwise. And it'll be starting in January. Facilities can apply to this. It may be that for communities that are not big enough to support a full service hospital, that this is a way to continue to offer emergency medical services and outpatient services in a community. We did get $5 million in funding in our budget this year to provide technical assistance. So we're going to be setting up a national TA resource to do that. We're also going to be giving money to the state offices of rural health and flex programs to become more educated about the REH and be able to respond to some of the questions they may be getting from their communities. And we're also working to identify model state licensure language that will be available later this summer through the National Conference of State Legislatures, because every state's going to need to have a licensure statute in place in order to license these new facilities. Next slide. I'd also just want to point out a really interesting resource that I think is worth your time and effort, and that is the Building Healthy Places Network, which really gets at sort of this broader view of healthcare along the lines of the social determinants of health. They put out a rural planning guide, and I think it's really well done. It may be a resource not only for you, but for the communities you serve. So I commend that to you as a potential resource. Next slide. As always, we would love for the Flex coordinators to serve as reviewers for us. You know rural and rural health better than just about anybody. And our whole entire grants process is better when we have rural people reviewing rural grants. And so we, if you have the opportunity to be a grant reviewer for us, we really would appreciate the help. Next slide. Please sign up for our weekly announcements. It's a way that we try to get the word out about key rural opportunities and resources. And it's pretty easy to sign up, and you can see so on this slide. And we'll go to the next slide. And really, I just wanted to just highlight a couple of things. I'm so glad that you're going to have a session right after me with our colleagues from the CMS, and in particular, the Innovation Center at CMS. And so really glad that Tequila and Ryan and Jackie and Darcy are all able to be a part of it. We greatly appreciate CMS's partnership in the Flex program. I think Christy Martinson and Rachel Moscato have done a fantastic job in terms of, you know, working closely with their CMS colleagues around quality measures and making sure that, you know, we've been able to align the Flex program in a way that ensures that CHs are not left behind in this national effort to make sure that hospitals are focused on quality and measuring the right things. At the same time, we know that not all measures are appropriate for CHs, and Christy and Rachel have done a good job, I think, of finding the ones that are relevant for you and task, and Stratus folks are a key part of that, as well as the Flex monitoring team. But that partnership with CMS is really the core of it. And so in addition to that, we're really thrilled about CMS finalizing the rules for the rural emergency hospitals I mentioned previously. They also just put out some new rulemaking around some really innovative things they're doing around shared savings. And all of that, I think, is from lessons learned from the work of the Innovation Center and the ACO investment model. So, you know, I think we just have a great partnership in all of the CMS staff. And so glad that you're going to have a chance to talk to them today. And I just want to thank them in advance. You'll hear more about their bios from the task folks. And then the final speaker, Darcy Graves, has been a key partner for us. We turn to Darcy on so many things because when we need to ask the right person a question at CMS, it's often difficult to know where to turn for that particular contact information. And I don't think there's anybody better than Darcy at connecting those dots. And she's also led some very important work in terms of research around minority health and around hospital bypass. And I commend a lot of that work to you all because I think it will inform you on your broader work. And so with that, I'll go back to Tracy and just thank you so much for the opportunity to join you. And I wish you a great rest of your meeting.
Thank you so much, Tom. It's always wonderful to hear the direction of the federal office. And I'm excited to introduce this next panel to you that helps, along with what Tom was just sharing, kind of show where we're bridging from what we've learned about healthcare models and those that have existed in the past, and what we've learned about health equity and health inequities into the vision of our country and our government, and then the strategies that we're implementing to get there. So I'm excited to kick off our first panel for you, and that's with panelists from the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, or CMS, as well as the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation, CMMI, on a health equity panel. We hope that at the end of this presentation that you, the participants, will be able to summarize the key rural health efforts that are happening within CMMI and the CMS Office of Health Equity, Minority Health Equity, to give examples of rural community transformation to support innovation and equity, and that you can also conclude how the state Flex programs can adapt these federal strategies into your programs to help reach to the future. So we have four panelists, and first I'd like to introduce you to Tequila Terry. Tequila serves as a director for the CMS Innovation Center, CMMI's State Innovation and Population Health Portfolio, where she there leads a team responsible for the design, implementation, and management of national healthcare payment reform and delivery models across Medicare and Medicaid. Ms. Terry holds a Master's of Business Administration from Emory University, a Master's of Public Health from Johns Hopkins University, as well as a Bachelor of Science in Sociology from Townsend University. Joining Tequila is Ryan Yoder. Ryan is a co-lead for the Community Health Access and Rural Transformation, or CHART model, at CMMI. And prior to leading the CHART model, Ryan supported the Pennsylvania Rural Health model, which is also housed in CMMI State and Population Health Group. And while at CMMI, Ryan obtained his Master of Science in Public Health from Johns Hopkins University. And through all these experiences, Ryan's worked on several rural-focused programs and research projects supporting access to care, care delivery, and harm reduction. Jackie Erdo serves as another model co-lead for the CHART model, and she's also the finance lead for the Pennsylvania Rural Health Model at CMMI. Now, Jackie's focus on the CHART model includes model quality strategy, care delivery transformation, and bridging Medicaid into alignment. And prior to her time at CMMI, Jackie oversaw efforts to ensure access to quality care and individualized care for those with cystic fibrosis. Jackie holds a master's degree in public health from George Washington University. And then the fourth panelist, as Tom was mentioning, is Darcy Graves. Darcy joined the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services Office of Minority Health in 2015. And as part of her work, Darcy assists in the coordination and implementation of priority agency and office-wide programs, policies, and products. Darcy leads the office's rural health portfolio. She serves as a co-chair to the CMS Rural Health Council as well. Darcy provides subject matter expertise in areas such as culturally and linguistically appropriate services, cancer, health literacy, and health equity. And Darcy holds graduate degrees in communications, religion and sociology, and public policy. And she has over 20 years of professional experience in the fields of cultural and linguistic competency and health education. So we're really excited about this tremendous panel. Darcy's gonna kick us off here with kind of painting the umbrella picture of CMS's strategies and how that interlocks with a specific strategy around health equity. Thanks, Darcy.
Thank you, Tracy, and thanks to Tom and all of my CMS colleagues who are on the call today, and the biggest thank you to the Flex team for inviting us to be here today and to talk to you all. As Tracy noted, I'm going to kind of provide kind of the overarching view, kind of the 30,000 foot view, and then pass it over to my CMS colleagues from the Innovation Center and let them provide some additional concrete examples. So for those who may not know, with this administration, we started this strategic planning that's built around these six strategic pillars, and all of which are super important, but just want to highlight, since this is the equity panel, this first pillar, which is about advancing health equity by addressing health disparities that underlie our health system. And it's important when we're talking about, to remember that when we're talking about equity and we're talking about disparities, we're including geography, we're including the rural urban disparities, as well as within rural disparities. Here is the definition that we use for health equity here at CMS. And really what it comes down to is having the fair and just opportunity to attain the highest level of health, regardless of your socio-demographic background. And the definition is quite lengthy, so I'm not going to read it verbatim, but you know, again, it includes gender identity, socioeconomic status, geography, preferred language, and other factors that affect access to health, which all of us who work in the areas of rural health know all too well. Just a little context setting in terms of the office that I sit in. We are one of several offices of minority health or health equity that sit within the Department of Health and Human Services. We have sister offices at AHRQ, the CDC, FDA, HRSA, NIH, SAMHSA, and then there is the HHS Office of Minority Health, which is pre-exists all of the other ones. My office in particular works to lead the advancement of integration of health equity in the development, evaluation, and implementation of CMS policies, programs, and partnerships. And again, that is inclusive of rural health. And one of the changes that we've made via the Rural Health Council in the last few years is to expand the representation of rural, or our understanding of rural, to be inclusive of rural, frontier, tribal nations, and the U.S. territories, because so many of the barriers that are faced because of geographic isolation, because of differing provider types or provider availability, can be addressed in a number of the same ways, or could be need similar considerations. One of the ways that we are helping to operationalize health equity at CMS is by the framework for health equity, which we released in April of this year. It was informed by stakeholder impact input, lessons learned, and pieces examining the literature and evidence-based over the last 10 or 15 years or so. It identifies five priority areas, and again, is inclusive of rural frontier tribal nations in the U.S. territories, amongst many other populations. Tom mentioned some of the work that we have done underway that we've led out of our office, but also some of the things that we've done more broadly for the agency and across the enterprise. Each year, my team and the CMS Office of Minority Health helps to publish an annual report. This is the picture of last year's cover, Improving Health in Rural Communities, FY 2021 in review, where we highlighted the COVID-19 vaccine administration, the expansion of postpartum coverage, which I'm excited to say continues to expand because we know what kind of barriers are faced with in rural maternal health care. And we've done a number of articles and recently released a report to reflect on those efforts that our office has done. Again, looking at the workforce, looking at long-term services and supports, thinking through quality, thinking through the mental health and substance use disorders, and making sure that we keep that broader net because we know that it's not just always opioid use disorders, but that additional substance use disorders also play a huge part in rural communities. Looking at Medicare payment and policy, and Tom mentioned the shared saving program. And so that is an important piece, as well as the rural hospital bypass, where we've looked at both inpatient services as well as outpatient services and why individuals may be bypassing their local hospital. All of these reports and more are on our rural health webpage, which is at go.cms.gov/ruralhealth. Before I pass things back to Tracy, I just want to highlight a couple more things. In addition to the research that I mentioned, our data policy and analytics group within the CMS Office of Minority Health produces research reports that, again, look at Medicare data. I know it's not always possible to run your own data or to have access to the data. So we produce reports as well as different files that allow folks to look at rural urban disparities in healthcare and Medicare, as well as looking at trend data for racial, ethnic, sex, and rural urban inequities in healthcare and Medicare Advantage. In addition to these reports, we also have the Mapping Medicare Disparities Tool, which lets you look at chronic conditions across different populations and frequently down to the county level. And so that's available on our website as well. I always want to make sure that folks know how we can work together. And I think this goes without saying for a number of my colleagues across the agency as well. But, look for those rules and regulations and respond to requests for information. All of that information is analyzed. All of those pieces come back to those rule and reg writers. And so having that information is hugely important. And so we do pay attention to all of those things. There is the Rural Open Door Forum. We encourage you to participate there. We're constantly sharing information and answering questions when possible. Each of the CMS regions, all 10, have someone who is designated as a CMS Rural Health Coordinator. So I encourage you to connect with them as well because they can help you with regional specific things and as just a great font of knowledge about all of the things. You can sign up for the CMS Rural Health Listserv, and you can find out more about all of these things by visiting go.cms.gov/ruralhealth. And with that, here are the websites that I mentioned. And with that, I will pass the microphone back to Tracy so that we can get to the next portion of our program. Thank you again so much.
Well, thank you, Darcy. That was tremendous. We really appreciate you giving that broad overview. For the group again, my name is Tequila Terry, and I have the privilege of working at the CMS Innovation Center with colleagues that you see on the screen, Ryan Yoder and Jackie Erdo. And we're really excited to be here today to talk to you a little bit about our work, what we do at the Innovation Center, how the principles that guide our work, the strategy we use, and then to talk specifically about a model that we are working on that really is designed to address rural health issues. It's the Community Health Access and Rural Transformation Model, or the CHART model, as you will hear us refer to throughout the presentation. Next slide. Before getting into the specifics of the CHART model, we thought it was important just to give you a little bit of information about who we are, for those of you who may not be familiar. The CMS Innovation Center was created under the Affordable Care Act, and really the purpose of the Innovation Center is to test innovative payment and service delivery models, really with the goal of reducing expenditures, enhancing quality, or some combination thereof. Next slide. So as we think about the portfolio that we have at the Innovation Center and the work that we do, everything that we do is really guided by our strategic vision. We released a white paper last year where we talked about our experiences over as an agency over the first 10 years and where we want to go in the next 10 years. And our vision is to have a health system that achieves equitable outcomes through high quality, affordable, person-centered care. And with that as our vision for the next 10 years, all of our work will really be focused on the five elements that you see on the screen. It will be to focus on driving accountable care, to make sure that we are advancing health equity, to support innovation and address affordability, and certainly to partner across the system to achieve system transformation. And so we're thinking about how the combination of value-based care and value-based payments and delivery system reform can really help to transform care, to get better outcomes, to reduce costs in rural communities in particular. We believe that moving providers away from fee-for-service so that they have more financial stability and can engage with communities to be active participants in delivery system redesign is really at the heart of what we do. Additionally, focusing on addressing disparities by raising the bar for really key areas of quality. All these things combined really are a formula for ensuring that we are working to support rural communities. And with that being said, we're going to talk today about the program CHART, the model CHART that we are running, and how it is being used in four key states as a way to really bring all of those elements together as a way to increase engagement of key providers, engage communities, address disparities. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Ryan, who can talk a bit more about the CHART model.
Thank you, Tequila. Hi, everyone. My name is Ryan. I am one of the co-leads for the CHART model. I will be providing just a bit of background for the model before handing over to my great co-lead, Jackie. So with that, as Tequila mentioned, we are standing up our CHART model. The model begins next calendar year and runs until 2028. The model consists currently of our community transformation track, you might hear us refer to it just as CHART or the Community Transformation Track. So just know we're kind of using those terms interchangeably. But the Community Transformation Track here provides upfront funding via a cooperative agreement to those four states that Tequila mentioned, predictable finances through a capitated payment, APM, and then operational flexibilities through benefit enhancements, engagement incentives, and beneficiary engagement incentives. The goals for the model, as Tequila kind of mentioned, up top about our statutory authority, are clearly to improve access and quality of care for rural beneficiaries, but also to increase adoption of APMs among rural providers, and most importantly to me, improve rural provider financial sustainability. I think both the pandemic and, as Tom Morris noted about the hospital closures, you know, financial sustainability for hospitals who are, you know, a bedrock of their community, keeps rural residents healthy and helps improve rural economies. With that, I think also, you know, for the CHAR model, our health equity North Star specifically is to make sure we're ensuring and maintaining access to high quality healthcare in these rural areas. Next slide, please. So as Tequila noted, we provided cooperative agreements to what we designated as our lead organizations back in October of 2021. Those lead organizations are three. We have four lead organizations. Three of them are the state Medicaid agencies in Texas, South Dakota, and Washington. And then our fourth awardee is the University of Alabama at Birmingham. So not the State Office of Rural Health themselves, but all awardees that are participating, you know, in where the FLEX program is being implemented. The way the model was kind of designed is those lead organizations are provided this cooperative agreement as kind of right grant money or seed money to get the model kind of up and running and work with, I think, the second type of actor we have in the model, which is participating hospitals, which can be a critical access hospital or an acute care hospital. These lead organizations, as part of the model, kind of define their the rural geographic region in which the model will be implemented, which we deem as their community. You can see here, this is kind of our, you know, theory of change in the model. So it starts with investment, providing technical assistance and funding to these lead organizations who are working with hospitals, you know, to transform healthcare delivery and to achieve these goals. Transformation happens in two kind of buckets on our mind. First, the transformation plan, which Jackie will get into in her section, which is basically a large strategic kind of healthcare delivery redesign strategy about how the beneficiaries in the geographic community that the lead orgs, you know, kind of self-select, how to improve the healthcare delivery for those beneficiaries. And then also, right, our alternative payment model, which provides, you know, prospective stable payments to participating critical access hospitals and acute care hospitals. I think from the beginning of the model design, we looked to see where we could fold health equity. Darcy was a great thought partner. Our colleagues at the Federal Office of Rural Health Federal Office of Rural Health Policy were also great partners. And to highlight just a few areas where we were able to kind of, you know, take health equity as less of a noun and more of a verb. I think here, our quality strategy, we have set quality measures in the model that we'll be reviewing and focusing on in terms of patient engagement and satisfaction and care coordination and readmission. But we also allow the lead organization and the hospitals to decide of and from a kind of a menu approach of behavioral health, substance use disorder, maternal health, or chronic disease prevention. Of those three, which bucket they believe they would like to focus on and kind of move the needle with as they implement the model. As far as the payment side goes, we have Medicare and Medicaid alignment in the model, which we think is important to, as Akila kind of noted, reach as many beneficiaries as we can, and also, you know, in turn, reach their safety net providers. We also in the capitated payment provide positive social risk adjustment for those in a community that serve a population with a higher social need than the national rural average. Next slide, please. And I think all of those many levers that I think we have and our, you know, state partners have and the rural providers is all focused right on community level transformation, you know, these kind of more population health based strategies. One way we kind of think about that as well in the design of the model is, as I mentioned, the lead organizations are the ones that get to, you know, decide which rural geographic area that they are implementing the model in. But as CMS, we do BINI alignment for based on geographic location for those beneficiaries as a way to prevent, you know, cherry picking. So we can really try to ensure that community level transformation efforts, you know, hopefully reach those with the help kind of close disparities and reach those who really need it. Our model also really tries to incentivize and encourage care coordination across the care continuum by leveraging telehealth and other strategies that Jackie will get into now. So Jackie, I'll kind of turn it to you to speak more about our transformation work.
Controlling the slides and also trying to share more information. So thank you, Ryan. So like Ryan said, I'm going to shift over into talking more about the community transformation plans, which are a core component of this model. And like Ryan said, we really wanted to create a model that enables rural communities and all of the many stakeholders in them to tailor their care delivery approach to what their community actually needs. So this is where the lead organization, in partnership with representatives from their community, outline their strategic priorities for care delivery transformation and the steps that they're going to take to get there over the course of the model. Transformation plans bring community needs, assets, and areas for opportunity to address access and quality of care, the adoption of alternative payment models, and support for financial sustainability. So prior to drafting transformation plans, each lead organization was required to conduct a needs assessment to identify any assets and gaps in their community. The needs assessment highlighted opportunities to capitalize on areas of strength and address local challenges. So the needs assessment includes the use of population health data to examine disparities in access to care, morbidity and mortality, and care quality, just to name a few areas. And much of this data that lead organizations use to form their needs assessment and to inform their transformation plans was pulled from the chart model's dashboard, which is a tool that CMS provides to lead organizations. It's a pretty robust tool that's continuously updated with Medicare and Medicaid data that is specific to each chart community. Data points include things like disease prevalence, area deprivation index, and expenditures by service category. And there's also the ability to do some slicing of the data and compare across different categories. So the needs assessment in combination with local priorities among rural beneficiaries both fold directly into each lead organization's transformation plan. So our lead organizations are required to think about short, mid, and long-term strategic priorities. And when we're thinking about short, mid, and long-term, we're talking within the context of the model, which, like Ryan mentioned, runs through 2028. Transformation plans must also describe how the lead organization plans to align their Medicaid program with the chart model, how they'll use technology to strengthen care delivery, and how their plans will address health equity. The chart model requires participants to develop a health equity strategy. So this includes clarifying which disparities lead organizations seek to address in their transformation plan overall. It also includes identifying barriers to delivering high quality care to underserved populations, outlining specific actions to tackle equity challenges, and developing a monitoring plan for all of this work. So transformation plan development is ongoing right now. As Ryan mentioned, the first implementation year of the model is 2023. So our lead organizations are gearing up for that. The four lead organizations are preliminarily refining transformation plans that really span the gamut of various approaches to improving access to quality care, supporting rural provider financial sustainability, and expanding the use of technology to support rural beneficiaries. One of the organizations is expanding the use of telehealth technology specifically to provide ongoing care for chronic conditions. Another is exploring ways to expand broadband access and enable telehealth use among their population as well. We also have ideas to create alternative transportation options, which I know Darcy highlighted as a concern for access to care for many rural beneficiaries who might need outpatient hospital care or who might be bypassing providers to get to another provider that might be providing the services that they need. We also have a lead organization that is enhancing dental and behavioral health benefits among their Medicaid population, building upon data sharing opportunities and finding better ways to connect rural beneficiaries to existing resources. And a number of our lead organizations are improving care coordination across rural health providers and across the care continuum. So we are very excited about what we're seeing so far and the work that these organizations have been doing. And we are very glad to be supporting the rural communities that they represent. So thank you so much.
And with that said, we will move back to the group. We did have on our last slide just some information about CMMI, and for those of you who are interested, ways to get more information. So we look forward to innovators in rural health reviewing the information on chart and engaging with us directly. Thank you.
Excellent. Well, thanks so much to all of our panelists. That was exciting to hear about kind of the overarching view of nationally what the strategy is among CMS and the Office for Minority Health, and then how that's coming into this model, particularly the chart model, and really the Pennsylvania Rural Health Model, which this audience in the FLEX program, which has been tuned into for some time, and kind of with Pennsylvania Rural Health Model, watch how that's occurred and how the FLEX program within Pennsylvania has been intimately involved. And how that program has evolved. And then with chart model and all of us hearing what that was and wondering what was going to be, and now we're on this kind of brink of it coming into action then in 2023. So that's very exciting, and I appreciate all the information you had to share. So I want to encourage our participants in this session to pop any questions that you may have for the speakers into the chat. And in the attendee hub, while you're watching this session here, there's a chat button in the upper right. You can click on that, and then it says join the chat, which you can then enter into, and it looks just like a chat room that we're used to within Zoom and things like that when we host webinars for you within TAS. So feel free to enter your questions in there. Our team is monitoring them, and then we'll ask the panelists here on your behalf. But I have a question or two to start off with. And first, to you, Darcy, one of the questions from the participants was wondering if the bypass report that you mentioned before reflects all states.
Absolutely. And thank you for that question. The inpatient services report, which I mentioned, is actually the first national analysis to explore the drivers behind why rural Americans bypass their local hospitals for patient care or patient inpatient care. And our outpatient report built on that evidence. And it's my understanding that a link to the page where those reports can be found is going to be put into the chat. So yes, it's a national mixed methods study to be a little more succinct, Tracy. Thank you.
Excellent. Okay, great. Yeah, thanks. And we will get those links into the chat box for everybody to follow up for more information. Another question for you, Darcy, and I have to refer to my notes here before. One of your slides talked about the fiscal year 2021 policy and research highlights, and there was a variety of things that, you know, the research was highlighting. So COVID-19 vaccines, postpartum coverage, workforce, long-term care services, quality, mental health and substance use disorders, payment and policy, and rural hospital bypass. So lots of big topics that I think we're often considering and pondering over within the FLEX programs. Are there any of those that you've seen so far in some of the research that have really shown some great success? Anything that stands out or jumps out to you in your mind? It was like, that was a really unique thing that such and such place was doing.
Unfortunately, the report doesn't capture all of the things that we know are happening out in the field. But I'm trying to. I think that the vaccine, the ingenuity and the novelty that we saw on vaccine administration in some of the rural communities, I think, really stood out to me. You know, hearing about. You know, and these are anecdotes that we get through listening sessions and those sorts of things. But hearing about, you know, vaccines being administered via dog sled in Alaska and those sorts of things is just, I think that to me, and I apologize for the ums, it was just, you know, when you have those moments, when you see the ingenuity, when you see the creativity that people who are living in these, because I think we don't always talk about all of the assets and all of the benefits and all of the amazing things that come out of rural. And so to really see that ingenuity to be highlighted and to be elevated, I think is really key. And that's what I thought, you know, were some of the great examples. There's a ton. I mean, I love seeing the postpartum coverage extensions and expansions that are happening across the country, and I hope that this has a huge impact on our people who are ready to give birth and you know want to do that in rural communities. That babies use when they want to arrive, and you may not have the time to get from your local rural hospital or you know your house to a setting that has those things. So making sure that folks have access is just huge. So,
thank you. Great. Thanks. And I realize I'm kind of putting you on the spot there. We're trying to pinpoint something. Hearing you talk about COVID-19, though, you know, I couldn't agree more. I have a background in public health. And so seeing what kind of unfolded in the synergy that occurred between healthcare and public health and other entities during the height of the pandemic, when we were all, you know, kind of wondering what's going on and trying to figure out solutions as quickly as we could, I think was really wonderful. One of the resources that jumped out to my mind for the audience that you may not be aware of is one of the other programs funded by the Federal Office of Rural Health Policy supports rural communities and rural hospitals and clinics in the Mississippi Delta region to transform into in their healthcare delivery models into those of value and longevity and sustainability. And one of the resources that was created on behalf of that program is a communications toolkit about COVID-19 vaccination that's available in a variety of different languages. And those templates can be utilized by an organization and then adapt those templates into their own branding, into their own personal touch, but the information is there for a rural facility to pick up and run with to support whatever they may need in terms of marketing and communication strategies out. And I think that's really beneficial when we think about being able to equitably share key health-related messages in ways that are understandable to the varied population that we're serving in our communities and maybe not just the dominant population. And that, of course, impacts health outcomes and the ability to seek services and have trust within the healthcare community to go seek those services. So that's just a resource I wanted to quickly highlight. Maybe one of our team can pop that into the chat box in the attendee hub for those to access. A different question I have about the chart model, and there's just so much going on with the chart model. Could one of you please repeat again the four different sites that are the chart model?
Yep, happy to. So we have four lead organizations, those that receive cooperative agreement funding back in October. Three of them are state Medicaid agencies located in Texas, South Dakota, and Washington. And then the fourth is in Alabama. It's the University of Alabama at Birmingham.
Okay, great. Yeah, so some nice geographic distribution there too. Can you, either Ryan, Jackie, Tequila, tell us an update about the type of geographic scope that each of those states have? In other words, will the states be working statewide or only in regions of the states? Maybe they're all four different, but kind of what's the breadth of what they're doing within their states geographically?
Yeah, I can take this one. So two of the states, which are Texas and Alabama, are looking at all of their rural counties statewide. And South Dakota is looking in their southwest region. I'm envisioning the state's map. And Washington is focusing their efforts in northwest Washington.
Okay, excellent. So a variety of different approaches there. I guess as to be expected with anything in rural, it's always a variety of different approaches. Okay, great. And so we know that those chart rules are expected to come out in January. What can you tell us about what will be required by the participating providers regarding community transformation plan or quality measurements? Any things that you can tell us right now that are knowns that you're not spilling the beans on?
Yeah, I can start off with this question, and Ryan, please jump in if you'd like to add to it. So our intention with CHART is for lead organizations to really work with their communities, especially the hospitals that choose to participate in the model, to tailor their transformation plan to what those communities need. So the expectation, I would say, is collaboration with the lead organizations throughout the model. And also, you know, each year there is an opportunity to update the transformation plans to some degree. So tailoring as we continuously learn throughout this model is also a great opportunity for each of our lead organizations and the providers that they're working with. And in terms of quality measurements, as Ryan mentioned, each of the lead organizations were able to choose a subset of the chart quality measures that they would like to focus on for the duration of the model. So those different, I guess, areas of focus are going to vary by state. But, you know, I think from the provider perspective, that's going to ladder right into the transformation work, because the quality measurements are really just a measure of how that transformation work is panning out, and a way for us to understand where we can make tweaks, where things are really strengthened, and how to keep moving forward.
Great. Thanks, Jackie. And as we're waiting for other questions in the chat, I have a question for you. So I realize, you know, a lot of this work doesn't start really occurring until next year. But I'm really curious about the different types of community providers that the hospitals and that are part of this project will be working with. So I'm not sure if you know that level of information, but, you know, with other types of community providers like mental health and EMS or even other health and human service organizations, are there specific examples that you can shine a light on that are being brought into the projects, either that are kind of the common ones maybe we would expect, or those that you were like, oh, that's really innovative, I like that idea? Any specifics to share there?
Yeah, I think the first thing that comes to mind is, right, kind of the way we have the capitated payment mechanism set up, right, is hopefully we can get to beneficiaries sooner, make sure that they're accessing a lot of preventative care as well, right? Which I think is a win-win for kind of everyone participating in CHART. So with that, some of the preliminary ideas we've seen from our lead organizations, right, has definitely been utilizing community health workers, expanding the community health workforce. Also, I think, right, there are so many, I think, kind of special types of rural providers as well. So though, the model, like, only critical access hospitals and acute care hospitals are eligible to participate in the model. I think we see them a lot leveraging, right, provider-based RHCs or, you know, neighboring RHCs and FQHCs in their community to, again, also try to reach those safety net providers and make sure that, you know, we are meeting beneficiaries where they are. Jackie mentioned the data dashboard that we provide to lead organizations via Tableau. And on that, we actually have a whole visualization of the different types of providers, pharmacies, FQHCs, RHCs, EMS, that are, you know, serving each lead organization's community so they can hopefully make those connections.
That's cool. So if I'm understanding correctly, then that dashboard right now is just for the four lead agencies to utilize, correct?
Yep, correct.
Will there be a point in time where some of that information might be public? I love all those visualizations for me. I'm like, ooh, that'd be really cool to see.
Yeah, I mean, we would love that. I think that is the ultimate goal.
Cool. Great. Awesome. Thank you. It's going to be fun to see that. So another question about charts. This is an interesting topic, and this is a big one, but what can you tell us about the participating hospitals, about how they'll be paid and how often? Can you break that down?
Yep. So I think as we alluded to, the model starts in 2023. First, we turn on Medicare payments on, right, the CMS side, if anyone is familiar. It's a bit easier for us to hold that lever. And then Medicaid kind of comes into the situation in 2024. Luckily, three of the four lead organizations are state Medicaid agencies themselves. We wanted to make sure we gave everyone ample runway to, you know, work with MCO contracts or SPAs or 1115 demonstrations. So that's kind of the when, the how. Speaking specifically for Medicare, is providers still submit claims as they normally would? I think that's helpful for provider burden to not kind of throw something new in the mix. And for reimbursement that would have been fee-for-service is now, right, being replaced by this capitated payment, which gets pushed out into bi-monthly, so twice a month checks. So at the beginning of the year, we're kind of in it right now, before folks kind of make the ultimate decision to participate in the model, we want to make sure they have full transparency and kind of provide them the, like, here is your expected reimbursement amount, and then we divide that into 24 equal payments to provide some kind of steady cash flow to aid them in their transformation plans.
Okay, cool. So yeah, in my mind, it's like, seems relatively straightforward but also complicated at the same time, so it's going to be fun to watch all of that too. So, but I appreciate all that, and I know that our facilities really need that steady cash flow. So having that reliance on something that can be different for them or riskier for them is really wonderful. So that's great. I think we have one more question coming in that I'm just kind of waiting on. Unless, Matt, you want to just speak and announce a question, that's wonderful too.
We had a request or a comment made that Texas has more than 50 rural hospitals at least interested in hearing more about participating, but they'll probably take no more than 14. Any comments or reflections on that?
Yeah, I feel like that is something we did hear in the beginning, but Texas is doing a bit more work since then. I know that they've expanded kind of like their community and have been engaging not only with hospitals directly, but also right towards the Texas Organization for Rural and Community Hospitals. So right, at least on our side, there's no cap to how many hospitals can participate. In our mind, the more the merrier. So I hope that's helpful.
Yeah, that was very helpful. Another question too is, what are y'all hearing? I know it's kind of been touched on, but what are y'all hearing about, like, interest or excitement from the ground level about this type of direction? What's your feedback just in general?
Yeah, I would say that we are definitely in the thick of the pre-implementation work. We have a lot of excitement with our lead organizations, and our partnership with them has been extraordinary. I think from the hospital perspective, there's a lot that a lot of focus on the capitated payment amount, which I think everyone can imagine is really important because part of this model is financial sustainability. So we're doing a lot of work to be responsive to any questions that are coming through from providers, to support lead organizations and any conversations that they're having. But overall, I think, you know, there's a lot of excitement, especially around the transformation plans, to really put pen to paper on what we want this model to be looking like over the next few years. And yeah, so we're just, there's a lot brewing right now. So we're excited for all that's happening, looking forward to it really coming together once our hospitals are really signed on to the model and we launch in January. I don't know, Ryan, if you'd like to add anything.
No, I think Jackie said it beautifully. Hospitals, right, are understandably nervous about, you know, any kind of new direction. I think that's something we've heard, Jackie and I both working on the Pennsylvania rural health model, Tequila's heard it in some of her round table discussions, that though fee-for-service, you know, isn't working, it's what folks know. So with everything, I think we just tried to have a really warm hand because I think we're all kind of going through this. We couldn't, as I think Darcy like really mentioned, and I would love to highlight, we really can't do this without local expertise. You know, I think everyone has a part to play in improving rural health and kind of closing those urban-rural disparities. So I think folks are maybe, again, understandably nervous, but hopefully nervous excited, which is, I think, where we are kind of sitting right now.
No, that's really good. Thank you so much. We really appreciate that. We do have a few more questions. I'll hand it over to Tracy.
Great, thanks. So kind of to get us back to the big theme and give the chart folks a minute to catch their breath here. What are some of the health equity strategies and actions that have short-term financial implications or payments for CHs? As most states aren't in an APM, an alternative payment model. So what are some of the health equity strategies and actions that have short-term financial implications and payment for CHs that might be a reality that right now a critical access hospital could consider and go and implement where they'd see that return right away on their bottom line?
Sure. Can I chime in and then kick it over to Ryan? So some of the equity strategies, they're very preliminary. Like I said, the transformation work is ongoing right now. But, you know, as Darcy mentioned, rurality and the rural versus urban disparity, it exists. So this whole model, a lot of the work that is happening around the equity piece is focusing on trying to make sure that access and quality of care is available to all the beneficiaries that are aligned to this model. So we've seen some work around supporting transportation options, I think was a really interesting one. Seems very simple in concept, but very difficult in execution. But I think, you know, one of the lead organizations that is working around that is thinking really creatively around how to bridge that gap and make sure people can get to the providers they need to go to at the times that they need to see those providers. We've also seen some focus around chronic conditions and narrowing the gap on comorbidities, substance use disorder and behavioral health disparities. And one interesting one that I found very creative is narrowing the gap in dental health disparities for Medicaid patients. So there's, you know, the strategies are being nailed down right now for some of these equity issues. But I think, you know, one creative strategy, again, simple in concept is making better connections to existing resources. That, you know, takes a larger organizational effort. But I think that is a sort of low hanging fruit that can make a really big impact on folks, both the providers and the beneficiaries, just to leverage those resources that already exist. So I think that's one interesting example that I've seen. Ryan, I'm not sure if any pop into your mind.
I think you hit them all from a chart perspective, and apologies, I putting it. I wasn't sure if the question was related to what can critical access hospitals do in chart specifically, or if it was a bit broader. So I might turn it to seriously to Kayla.
Yeah, no, and I know we're almost on time. So I think I'll just say, you know, the health equity strategy should be focused on whatever disparity it is that you're trying to address, because as you know, there's lots and lots of health equity strategies out there, but you have to be able to focus it on what is what you're trying to address within your community. So looking at some of the data elements that we talked about, looking at some of the population pieces that this panel has spoken about, and figuring out if you have within rural disparities or if you have rural urban disparities, and then, you know, starting to narrow the scope from there. And I can say if health equity is something that your organization is interested in, CMS offers a health equity technical assistance program. And so you can reach out to healthequityta@cms.hhs.gov and say, hey, we're interested in figuring out what health equity strategies might be most appropriate for us. And we have a team that's dedicated to help kind of connect those dots.
Oh, that's excellent. That's a great resource. Thanks for sharing that. As you were sharing, Jackie, about the transportation kind of solution, I was thinking about hearing about a model in the Northeast, and I can't recall if it was Vermont or New Hampshire, so I apologize for that. But it was a critical access hospital community that had created a volunteer transportation service, sort of like a volunteer taxi service, if you will, to support people getting to and from their doctor's appointment. So it was kind of like an Uber-like service, but just that one that you did not pay for. And it was staffed by retirees who were interested in supporting their community and helping out others. And you know, the short-term financial return for the facility to have that is such that they didn't have as many no-show appointments anymore. So they were then, you know, able to get paid because people were presenting to their appointments instead of having that time block on the provider's schedule that was then blank. And one of the things that happened with that model, and forgive me, I can't recall what the name of the community is off the top of my head, but they then expanded to support doing a food share delivery. They had a local farmer's market in the community, and then were able then to transport some of the foods from the farmer's market to those that were in need of some healthy foods, which also supports well-being and things like that. So probably not an exact financial return for the facility because of that, but there are long-term, of course, implications with that. Another thing that I wanted to share here kind of as we wrap up and close is that the center supports another federally funded technical assistance center called RIT, so the Rural Hospital Provider Transition Project through F4HP. And that program just held a summit meeting within the last 4 weeks about understanding rural health equity and quality and value-based payments. And we expect those results from that summit to be released here at the end of August. And there should be some really excellent examples in there on how we in rural, in our small rural hospitals, rural clinics, and critical access hospitals, along with other partners, can tie into rural health equity and promote that transition of value, whether or not you're within an alternative payment model or not. So look for that to come, and we'll be sure to share that resource from RIP through TASC out to the state flex programs as well. So with that, I really wanted to take the time and say thank you to the four excellent panelists that we had here today. We appreciate you taking the time out of your busy lives and your busy work schedules to support us here in the Flex program, to wrap our heads around what's happening nationally with a health equity strategy, what's happening in these different transformation models that we're hearing so much about and their implication in rural, and how we can start to think about how we can translate some of those activities then into our state Flex programs. So thank you. To our participants, we're adjourned now for a break until 1:30 Central Time. After the break, we'll be convening again for a plenary session from the Flex monitoring team, talking to us about the future of Flex. And then after that, we'll move into breakout discussions to kind of ponder more deeply what that means for us. So please join us again at 1:30 after your break. And the link to that session is back in the main attendee hub. And we'll see you then. Thank you.